So much for joining. I am Nabila. I am going to be the facilitator for this session. Just in case if you need closed captioning, you should see the option below to you can just check subtitles, and if the subtitles option is not showing up, just click on more. It should be there. And just to let you know that this meeting is being recorded, and I will be coming in at the end just to share a survey with you guys, because of course we appreciate any feedback you have to give us. And I will also sh be sharing the link to the survey in the chat. So thank you so much. Enjoy, and over to you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Tiffany Quash here with Eric Schuler and Jesse Breen from Jesse, did I say your last name correctly?
That's Breen.
Breen from the
It's okay.
library. I'm
Works.
sorry, I'm sorry. But we're gonna go ahead and get started. Jesse, did you want to go first?
Sure, why not?
Okay.
I have my own set of slides because they're being very uncooperative. So hold on one second. Let me see if I can figure out how to make this work. You would think by this point in time we'd have all learned, but all right, so you should be seeing the backside of the presentation. And let's see if I can get you to the front side. Is that presenting?
Yep,
Real
you're
slides?
presenting,
Okay, cool.
presenting. Yep.
Unfortunately, I don't have the title slide. Sorry, I didn't make one of those. But I'm Jessica Breen. I'm from the University Library. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the research data resources that are specifically available through the AU Library. And as an academic research library, we have quite a few of those, as you might imagine. Everything from actual data resources to assistance with research publishing, data management plans, LibGuides, and consultations and support with actual individuals. So let me see if I got a functional mouse. I do. Right. So we have in our collection the subject librarians, each of whom has a special subject that they work with. Also, they're all liaison librarians to different colleges. So you have, as a faculty member, you have a librarian assigned to your college and probably somebody who's specific to your discipline. They collect in their work databases. We buy books and journals, certainly, but databases are increasingly the thing that we get. We have currently 635 of those. And if you were to go to our A to Z database website, which is, there's a link there at the top of the slide, and you'll be getting copies of these, you can see the search for this. One of the ways that you can search them is by filtering by type, and data is a type of database. Those are the databases that actually have downloadable data available on them. So you can search by type, and then search by your subject if you like. You can also make use of the icons that are in our on our page here. And you can see there is, if I click the button, little highlights, there's an icon that will identify downloadable data databases. And those are ones that actually have tabular data you can get a hold of and use in your classes. Simply Analytics is an example of one of those here at the bottom. You can see it actually has two different icons. It has downloadable data available as well as being a full text database. And the thing I wanted to point out here, if you're going to be using the databases in class with students, one thing to know is that some of them do have limited numbers of seats available. So Simply Analytics is a great database. It has downloadable data. You can make maps in it. You can do data visualization with those maps. It's a lot of demographic data, largely from the US Census and federal sources. But it only has five concurrent users. So if you're trying to use this in class, it won't work, sadly. But a lot of them don't have this. Some of them do. Just be aware of the ones that do if you're going to use them in class. In addition to these databases, oh wait, I changed my slide order. We have two new databases that I wanted to tell you about real quick. The ArcGIS Living Atlas of the World. So I'm a geographer. I'm very excited about this one. This is the data layer database for all of the mapping data that we get with our new site-wide Esri license. So from this database, you can search for base maps, imagery layers, vector data. There's also freestanding apps and maps that live in this, but you can search for there's like 10,000 different layers of data that are in here. And all of these are then usable in our ArcGIS software. So this is a great one to look at. We also just got this one, Sage Data. It's part of a larger set of databases that we got that's Sage Research Methods. But Sage Data specifically has downloadable data in it. And you can see here that there's all these different subjects that there are there. You can also search by source, which is very nice if you're looking for a particular authoritative source for your data. And you can search by geography. The research methods part of this database setup also includes tutorials, both video and written, for using some of this data. So if you're looking for clean, ready-to-use data for classwork, this is a great source of that, because it also has little videos that'll help students get their way through it. And again, we have 600 plus databases. My colleagues in research, teaching, and learning will be having their talk on next Wednesday, where they're gonna tell you about 60 of the databases in 60 minutes. This is a reprise of their talk from last year. So I have a little blurb here telling you when and where to go see the new version, but also there's a link here at the bottom to the version they did last year. So they're hitting like 10% of our databases every year. So eventually they'll get to the end of them. But there's a lot of really interesting stuff in there. We have databases of videos and music, and not just journals. There's more to it than that. In addition to these databases that we have, we do also buy and host individual data sets. And those live on the American University Research Archive, or AURA. You may have been familiar with AUDRA. AUDRA got replaced by AURA. But within AURA, we have these individual data sets. So these are things that we have acquired and that we host on our own. And these little pictures here, these are some of the things that are in there. We have Gallup data, we have a lot of election data. There is a ton of international population data in there, as well as some international census data. And these are the statistical and textual collection and the geospatial data collection. Both of those data collections have a lot of data that's possible to be mapped in them. But the primary difference between the two is that the statistical and textual data collection is tabular data. It's in tabular formats. There's a couple of just straight text documents that are in there. Iterate in particular is one of those, but most of them are tabular format. The geospatial data collection is actually in geospatial data format. So those are files that are actually able to be immediately mapped. Coming this semester, we're actually getting an upgrade to the geospatial data collection, and that collection will be available directly through our ArcGIS software. So kind of similar to that living atlas that we saw a few minutes ago. Oh, and in order to access these data sets, this happens sometimes where folks try to get to them and get a little confused about what's going on. You need to be on campus or using the AU VPN to actually open these things. They're restricted to AU users, and so there's that block on them. So if you're trying to look at them and you can't see them, make sure you're logged in. AURA is also our institutional repository. So in addition to hosting this data set that we buy, the institutional repository is also where you can put your research materials. And so you can put your article preprints and reprints there. But really importantly, you can also put things like working papers and conference presentations, the data sets that are part of your articles that you published. Those can all live there. And they all get a DOI attached to them, a digital object identifier. And that is a way that we are able to help you make links, permanent links to your research that you can use anywhere. They're very commonly used in journal articles. You've probably seen them underneath, you know, the list of authors. There's almost always a DOI listed on a journal. This would enable you to have one of those identifiers for anything you put into AURA. You can also, pre-publication, claim a DOI so that you're able to use it as you're writing, to actually have that link to where your data is going to live or where your journal article is going to live. And if you have questions about how to do that, you can email datasite@american.edu and they will sort you out. Another thing that we offer, we have the DMP tool. So a research data management plan. There's a couple of places on campus where you can actually get assistance with these. The one that we do here in the library, we have the DMP tool. It's a web-based tool. It offers templates with funder requirements to simplify the process. But what these are, a lot of federal agencies, largely NIH and NSF, they use these as part of grant applications for you to tell them how you're going to store and share your data, because these are increasingly requirements for getting grants from those organizations. They want that data to be able to be shared and built upon. So these management plans, they talk about what kind of data you're going to collect, the metadata you're going to use on this, how you're going to store it and share it. It's no longer acceptable to say that I'm going to put it on a USB drive and put it in a drawer. It needs to be somewhere where people can get a hold of it. And so these research management plans, they talk to the funder through what exactly you're going to do. And Aura kind of connects to this, in that Aura is one of those places where you can store your data. So we can help you with this if you'd like. We also have a ton of LibGuides. There's actually 240 of them as of this morning. They're always growing. These are essentially little blogs that the librarians write. A lot of them are finding guides, so they actually help you find a particular kind of data. Some of them are more about the kind of data and about how to use it. So these were the six that I thought would be the most useful for folks who are looking for help with research data. This research data across the lifecycle LibGuide is expansive. It covers the whole deal from beginning with IRB all the way through where you're going to keep your data. GIS and cartography is a finding guide for geospatial data, as well as it'll tell you about the software that we support in the geospatial research lab within the library. Data management plans, what it says on the tin. Systematic reviews are a new one for us. The librarians are actually assisting in that kind of research. And so that's another one of those very explanatory LibGuides. The finding data and statistics guide, if you try to click on that one today, it will not work. It's in the process of being redone. It'll be live by next week. It's one of those collections of data that kind of grows and grows, and it has to be weeded every now and then. And so the librarians are working on that. But it will be done here shortly. And the last one is one of the very specific LibGuides about finding the data that's actually available in ICPSR, because there's a little bit of a, it can be difficult to do sometimes. And so there's a little bit of a helper in that LibGuide. And if you're looking for more of those LibGuides, again, there's 240 of them. There's a link there to the AU Library homepage where you will find a tab called Subject Guides. And that's what LibGuides live. Additionally, we also offer consultations and support. So on our website, you can always go to the Ask a Librarian, that live chat that actually is live. It's an AU librarian who will speak to you during the library's open hours. After hours, we have a service who answers those for us, but they are also librarians. You can schedule a one-on-one consultation. Again, you have a subject librarian for your field, and you have a liaison librarian who is attached to your college. Those are great people to set up consultations with if you're interested in finding resources in your field. There are also slightly more specialized consultations and support that's available. So my colleague, Rachel Borchardt, who is the scholarly communication librarian, she can talk to you about Aura, about those DOIs, about our open access publishing. So if you're trying to publish in an open access journal, she's the person who's the expert on how we deal with that and how it's funded. You can also come to me for help with geospatial and research data. So again, I'm a geographer. I run the geospatial research lab, and I can help you with the methodologies behind actually using GIS and helping you find data and how you plan a project in that. So we have a lot of support in the AU library for research. Please come and contact us. We're happy to see you, happy to meet. And I think that is my last slide. It is.
Awesome. Right.
I relinquish the floor.
Thank you, Jesse. So I'm going to share our slides. Okay, I'm going to ask the million-dollar question. Everybody can see my slides, yes? Fantastic. So I'm going to start off with, okay, I am screen sharing. So Dr. Schuler and I are going to start off with reasons you book a consultation. So I'll start off with the ifs and you want to book a consultation, and then Dr. Schuler will come in and talk about areas where we do not assist in booking a consultation. So reasons why you would want to book a consultation is there are questions about your analysis. There are questions about which appropriate program to use. There is uncertainty about planning your research. And if there are methodological questions about a grant proposal, these are all reasons why you would want to book a consultation with us. And our consultations are about 45 minutes long. and you can come meet us in through our, and we'll talk about the booking system in a minute. But they're 45 minutes long, and you have an opportunity to meet with us in person on certain days, and then definitely on virtually as well. And then I'm going to hand it over to Eric.
Hi everyone, good to see you all on this Thursday morning. I keep thinking it's Friday, but it's actually Thursday, so that doesn't bode well. But good to see you all. Just going to back up for a quick second. So I handle the quantitative computational. Tiffany handles the qualitative and survey methodology. So that's kind of where we kind of focus our efforts on. If there's things about like mixed methods, we try to tag team and help out the best we can. So we're not trained mixed methodologists, but we help each other out. We try to make it work. So if you do mixed methods, we're here to support as well. It's just we come at it from different lenses. So areas that we don't provide assistance with, though, for consultations is we don't provide technical support for AU applications or desktop system. We're not here to complete your analysis for you or to run your analyses for you. We don't do classroom demonstrations. We're faculty facing. We don't teach or troubleshoot software, and we're not responsible for teaching your students how to use the software in your class. So if you're teaching with a program, we have different online resources, on-demand videos. Those can more than help you to share those with your class. But we're not here to troubleshoot and teach your students how to use the software that you'll be teaching in class. We also won't write IRB applications for you. And we're not here to develop and state theoretical lenses a researcher should use. So that's going to be more ownership on you as the researcher and as a subject matter expert. We come from different disciplines, so we try to make sure we take a really broad approach, but you're the subject matter expert, and we want to make sure that you're driving the bus, so to speak.
Okay. So programs that we support as far as qualitative and survey include Qualtrics and Invivo. Those are the two programs that we have here on campus. Now, Teget is a open source program that if you come to the Teget training later on today, we can talk about it. But those are the three programs that I can definitely assist you with. I am not familiar with Atlas TI. I've used it once, maybe twice, and definitely am very familiar with Deduce because of my own research. But these are the three programs that we definitely provide assistance with in CTRL. And then Eric.
Sure. For quantitative, we got a big list there, big list of programs. So these are the main ones we provide support for. I provide support for. So that's gonna be RR Studio, Python, JASP, Jamovi. I put the free ones up on top because I'm a huge proponent of open source, open programming, open data. So I really believe that we should be teaching and all using open source statistical programs. So I preface those ones up. All my trainings are using open source programs for that as well. There's also, we provide support for SPSS, Stata, Excel, SAS on demand. We no longer have a campus-wide license. So if you're using SAS and you do not have a campus-wide license, you'll want to use SAS on demand. I have some videos on how to get started with that. I don't personally have a copy of SAS, but I know it enough and can help out with debugging stuff and troubleshooting that, no problem. We also have MATLAB that can be installed on any computer at all. So if you want it on your personal one, if you want to have it on your work computer, awesome, go for it. Not a problem. Mathematica, same deal. I'm also one of the point of contacts for the high performance computer support. So if you want to start using the HPC, which a little bit of a spoiler, we just got a brand new shiny HPC. It is live, it's deployed, and it is awesome. It's a lot of GPUs. It is fun. I've had the joy of running through with it a bunch of jobs this over the summer, and it is great. So if you're interested in that, let me know. I kind of help folks get up and running with the high performance computer, help troubleshooting it. So if you're interested in that, send me an email and happy to get you on board with that. There's also some other programs not listed here that even though we do not formally provide support for, I can help out with, like M plus, LizRel, and some of the more specific latent variable programming. That's one of my expertise is latent variable modeling. So I'm familiar with a lot of the different programs on how to do that. So it's not listed because we don't have licenses for it, but if you're using it, I could probably help out with that too. But yeah, so we also have ICPSR. So we work with the library on this too. So if you're interested in using ICPSR, reach out. If you're trying to use restricted access data, just want to let you know that it's you're not going to come to us to have us sign off on that. That has to go to the Office of Research. So we want to make sure that's you don't want to send us that documentation. If you do, we're going to have to forward it on. So just want to make sure it's nice and efficient, and you don't get kind of stuck with that for your research. We want to make sure we keep on pushing your research forward. Yeah, let me, I can take the next one.
Okay, sorry about that.
No problem.
I was just so excited.
So we've
Go ahead.
okay.
No, go
No, go
ahead.
ahead. No, go ahead. Go ahead.
So we do offer customized trainings. These are geared toward faculty and faculty research labs. These are not classes. So please, we want to emphasize these are not your classes. These are your research labs. So go ahead, Eric.
Yep. So we're providing customized trainings for your research labs or for you as a researcher. So for quantitative, this could be basic or advanced analyses like SEM, multi-level modeling, interactive dashboards in R or Python. Python for SEM and some other stuff, it's not as well developed as R comparatively for certain things. Otherwise, there's other things that Python's fantastic for that R kind of doesn't do all that nicely, but if you're interested in any of that stuff or having a customized training, I've done a bunch of those throughout the last year and a half. Love doing them. But yeah, just I also try to focus this on open source. That way, especially if you're training students in your research lab, they're able to take these tools, use them after AU. They don't have to have a license for the software. And also, it's a fantastic tool for the tool belt for job applications too, being able to do this. Because if you know how to do this in R or Python, you can easily do this in SAS or Stata. But yeah, I'll pass it over to Tiffany for the next part.
So with Qualitative, we can have a customized training toward in vivo and Qualtrics. Now let me reiterate, with in vivo, we do not, and I do not provide assistance with the cloud. So I mean, that's in the cloud is where you have multiple people sharing information. So that's something that we don't have access to as far as our license is concerned. Yes, it costs a lot of money. So you would have to contact customer support if that's something that you are interested in. But if it's just using in vivo, that is something that I can help with. And then Qualtrics, definitely in a team setting. If you know we can get you in a group and have a group data, I'm going to say database for what for lack of better words, through Qualtrics, or we can collaborate the Qualtrics survey. That's not a problem at all. We do ask that you provide us with 2 to 3 weeks notice along with specific topics that you would like to be covered along with the data sets. I you know as much as maybe Eric and I like to say that we are amazing geniuses at this, it does require us to have some time with working with your data. So if you can just please, please, please allow us to work with it within the 2 to 3 weeks in advance. That would be really helpful to us.
And something I want to add to that too with this, and I'll ask for like really specific granular topics like descriptive statistics, what specifically you want covered, what specific univariate analysis, what specific parts of multi-level modeling do you want covered? Just because I don't know exactly what you need for your research or your research lab, and what's within your discipline, what are the specific things that you really need to be successful in for manuscript or for research within this? So the more information I have, the better. But that also comes at a little bit of a cost because if it's really specific, I need to spend time kind of figure out the code, test it, make sure everything's running right. And then I also really, really love to have a data dictionary or a code book with a data set. Because a lot of times I'm trained as an experimental psychologist. My research is more in educational psychology. That's kind of where I live for research-wise. So if it's like an econ data set, or just law criminology data set, I don't really understand what's going on there. So the more information you can give me, the better. Because I'll just start randomly pulling data variables in there, and that's, yeah, you don't want that. Nope. Yeah, quantitative computational research. So I want to give you kind of a little bit of like how I tend to structure consultations and my mindset and lens I come into this with. again, trained as an experimental psychologist, more that ed psych focus. So I really like kind of talking through like how to kind of do that scaffolding as we build analyses and kind of really building the tools and the confidence in something that might be a new analysis or a new software for you. So I love kind of taking that scaffolding approach. For me, it's always kind of thinking through and planning analysis what you're going to run before you collect the data, if at all possible. Because sometimes if you're trying to figure out what analysis you have after you've collected the data, that's going to really limit what you can and can't do for your analyses. You'll have to be stuck with certain type of analyses if you have like an ordered logit or like an ordinal variable for an outcome versus a continuous. So different things will come into play. So I always like to have a conversation early on and kind of really give you a bunch of different options, and these routes will give you these potential options. So if it's at all possible, please talk to me early on. Happy to talk through those options. If possible, simulate or run a pilot test. I love doing statistical simulations. I love that stuff so very much. So I don't really do a lot of human subject data personally. All my stuff is simulation based, so I love doing that. But kind of making sure, like, create a fake data set or do a pilot test, run the analysis, make sure everything's all the data is in a usable format. Because if it's not in a usable format later on, then that's not going to set you up for success later on. That's going to be more work, more effort. I always like to think about what's the alignment between your research questions and your hypotheses and the analysis. So whenever I meet with someone, I always ask, well, what's your research question? What's your hypotheses? And making sure there's alignment. Because if you're talking about these overall latent constructs, but you're running a t-test, well, that's a mismatch. So now we got to take a step back and really kind of talk through this. So making sure everything's in alignment. Because otherwise, there'll be instances where you have data, you have research questions, but it's a misalignment. So actually, you can't answer your research questions that you have because your data is in such a way. So I always like to have that conversation early on. Also, kind of talk through the designs and measures. I love psychometrics. That's where I live, is psychometrics. So I love talking about measurements, making sure you have a good measure, you're able to get adequate responses within that, and you know what you're measuring. And also to kind of talk through on how to avoid fatal flaws. That being said, there's no such thing as the perfect research design or the perfect study. That's a lie. So there's always going to be limitations or weaknesses, and just kind of doing the best you can with what you can as well. And if your study is underpowered, I always like kind of talking through power as well, running a power analysis, different ways of doing that. Happy to walk you through that as well. I like having a buffer for 30% additional participants if you're working with human subjects data, because that way, if you have missing data or chaos response with people just kind of making little pictures on the survey, well, that's an issue. So making sure you have a nice buffer to have adequate power. And then when I was doing graduate training, this was right at the start of the reproducibility crisis, or the replication crisis in psychology. So I'm a big proponent of data documentation, annotated code. That way you have it all set and ready to go in a nice container when someone asks you for it. Because I've been there when folks have emailed me like, hey, can I have a copy of your data set? And I have to spend the next 2 days frantically trying to create a data documentation because I never thought someone would ask me for it. I've learned that mistake, so now I always recommend do that in advance.
So, with qualitative and survey research, things that we would like for you to consider is your research. Like, what is your research question and what's your theoretical framework? The hardest part about doing a consultation, I think, regarding qualitative research is having somebody not knowing what their research question is, one. And then when I ask the question, so what's your theoretical framework, not having the slightest idea of what I'm talking about. And it's really hard to have that consultation with somebody who doesn't understand either of those aspects. So please, please, please come prepared when I ask those questions for to you. Your data collection, when we're talking about what is your research procedures, like how are you gathering your data? Are you doing interviews? Are you doing observations? Are you doing an arts-based research? There's different ways of collecting qualitative data. I mean, I know this current study that I'm doing, it's we're using social media for a survey. Just be able to explain all that information while we're sitting there during your consultation is really helpful. I think it's also really important for you to understand what your positionality is. So if you're able to say, well, my positionality is this, and we're covering, and your theoretical, let's say your theoretical framework is critical race theory, how are you positioning yourself within critical race theory? Because you can't just throw out all these words and not have the slightest clue what's going on. So I think it's just really important for you to understand how you position yourself, not only with your theoretical framework, but how you are as a researcher. That's really, really important. Now, I will say this, you need to become familiar with Qualtrics and Vivo or whatever the qualitative data analysis software or QDA is. For some people, maybe it's their first time using it, but definitely as a student, take a hold of those trials. I do know that Deduce, for instance, has like, I think they're a month or a 2 week trial to use, or just take advantage of those trials. Run through that program. Just with Qualtrics, you cannot break Qualtrics. Let me just tell people that now, you can't break it. In Vivo is a little messy to use because it's just a little complicated. I will openly admit to that. It's personally not my favorite program. Eric's saying he's trying to break Qualtrics. You can't break it. So just play around with it. Don't be afraid. Reflect. Are you answering your research question? This goes back to, what is your research question? How are you positioning yourself? What is your methodology? Think about all of those things, those aspects when answering your research question. Does your analysis align with your theoretical framework? I also want to add, does it align with your positionality? It's really, really important. And have you given yourself enough time to process your experience? So I will say, like, I know when I was writing my dissertation, I wrote my dissertation at the beginning of the pandemic. And I did 25 interviews within about 6 months, 4, 5 to 6 months. And that's relatively a quick turnaround time. I didn't have time to process everything that was going on because of the pandemic, because I was trying to do these interviews. And this was way before Zoom actually had the transcript. So I was doing my transcriptions by hand. It was a mess. But the whole point was is that I hadn't given myself enough time to process all my feelings or what I was going through. You know, qualitative is a little touchy-feely, and unlike quantitative. So, I mean, you just have to give yourself enough, and that's not knocking quantitative for the record. So, but you just need to give yourself enough time to process what's going on. If you would like to book a consultation with us, go ahead and scan the QR code. Or you can get a just hop on the link and you can book a consultation with us. If you have booked a consultation with us in the past, the old link is different. It will not work. So please, please, please go through either the website or book the consultation by scanning the QR code.
A couple things I want to add. Oh, sorry. I just want to add a couple quick things about the new consultation system for booking. If you're booking a Zoom one or even in person, do try to plan in advance, just because that way, if it's in person, we can make sure if there's a room booked, that if we're meeting like at the library or another place on campus, that we're able to reserve the room and time. Also, because it no longer automatically sends a Zoom link because we're using a different system for this. So we have to manually create a Zoom link and send that over. So it's... if it might just take a little bit of time to get that to you. So usually like the next business day or two, just want to give you a heads up with that. I also want to say too, with the consultations, we treat them as confidential. So we're not sharing your data. We're not sharing your specific questions. We're not doing anything like that. We take it very, very seriously within this for confidentiality. We do report things like, did we meet with you? How long did we meet you with? In like a one sentence, quick summary, really, really high level. That's just for trends that we're seeing within our consultations. But I know that I've been doing this for a while for consultations. It's a moment of vulnerability, and that's okay. It's better. We're happy to talk with you, and we're here to support you. You don't have to feel bad or feel ashamed that you don't know something. That's okay. There's no way that we can know everything too within this. And I'll openly admit in consultations, like, I need to check on this because I'm not 100% sure. Let me get back, do some research, and I'll get back to you. And that's an okay position to have. And also, like, we don't expect you to be an expert in everything. That's unrealistic. So there's always going to be room for growth. There's always going to be room to develop new skill sets. And we're here to help you out with that.
So this is our Q&A time. I am going to stop sharing my screen and ask what questions do you have for myself, Jesse, or Eric? And you don't have to be scared. I just want to add, like during the consultations, sometimes it's always helpful to hear, oh, I really wish that you had a workshop on X, Y, and Z. And maybe that's really a great time to hear that. Because when we're creating workshops, or at least I know when I'm creating workshops, maybe it's just a repeat of things that I've done in the past. And it would really be helpful for me to hear, oh, you know, I looked through all of your on-demand videos and I looked online and I looked here and I couldn't find this, or maybe I found this and I just didn't really understand. So that's a really great time to hear, oh, by chance, have you had a workshop on that or on this particular topic? And maybe we haven't. And so it would be really great to get some of your ideas. Also, Eric, I was getting ready to talk about our researcher spotlight as well. What we are doing in CTRL is if you are teaching a qualitative or quantitative survey class or research methods class, excuse me, we are highlighting faculty members who are doing this type of research, or research or teaching, excuse me, research methods. And so if you're teaching research methods, please get a hold of Eric and I so you can be a part of our faculty spotlight.
I just put this in the chat, but I also mentioned it verbally too, that well, in the next couple of weeks, if you go onto our software on demand webpage on CTRL, a lot of these are some of them are outdated. So we've actually been working on updating all of those. So it's gonna be newest versions of R, newest versions of Python. I recorded one how to use Spider, how to use Jupyter Notebook, all that fun stuff. So those are all gonna be updated in the near future too. And then if there's additional stuff that you'd love to see, just let us know.
I forgot to mention something earlier about our data resources in the library. We have funding to buy data. So that's one of the things that I do. I buy geospatial data and I now buy our statistical and textual data since the retirement of our research data librarian. So if there is a data set that you would like to use for your research and can be made accessible to the entirety of AU's community through the library, send me an email. There's a form on the library website, but you can also just send me an email directly, and we can talk about it and figure out if it's something that we can purchase for you. But people very rarely take us up on this, and we have money, so ask.
Oh, I'm gonna ask, Jesse. Trust me, I'm gonna ask. And I also put in the chat, we have a podcast called Calling Outside the Memos, where myself and a colleague of mine, Lizzie, Dr. Lizzie Bartelt from University at Buffalo, we talk about all things qualitative, positionality. We talk to other scholars. This is not just for emerging scholars. We try our best to get in touch with other faculty members from other institutions. So check it out, please, at your local podcast station.
One more library plug. So CTRL is faculty facing. The library is actually faculty and student facing. So we do have the ability to send a librarian to your class to talk about data, to talk about methods. So that is something you can also book on the library website. And if depending on, you know, if you're busy at 3 o'clock this afternoon, I'm giving a talk about the Geospatial Data Research Lab and what we do in there around methods and things that we can help you with and do with classes and stuff like that. So I would love it if you come see me later. I do realize that Tiffany and I are going head to head at the 3 o'clock slot, though. little competition.
No competition at all whatsoever. It's
all being
Qualtrics.
recorded.
It's all being, yes, pick your challenger. It's all being recorded. So if folks could please fill out the, where did Nabila go? Oh, there she is. Thank you, Nabila. If folks could please fill out the survey, that would be great. Then we know what we can bring to future August faculty workshops when talking about research data and methodology support. So please, please, please click on the link or click on the QR code. That would be fantastic. Is there any interest for a workshop on teaching STEM subjects such as quant methods to non-STEM students? I'm looking at Eric.
Just kind of thinking through that. Send me an email, happy to chat, and we can try to get something on the books. I think that'd be fun. So yeah, that'd be interesting. Love to learn more and love to talk about it. So yeah, just let me know.
For GIS, our workshops are typically aimed at just new users. So we use quantitative and qualitative data in those workshops. I haven't booked one recently. People tend to not book things in person. But we can videotape one and do that if anyone's interested in a geospatial version.
We're going to share these slides. We can, I believe, the presenter information. We have access to all of your emails, and so we can forward the emails to folks then.
We will also have the recording of the session uploaded to our YouTube channel. So if you just want to rewatch it, you're welcome to do so. The YouTube channel should have it within like 2 weeks or so.
Thank you, Nabila.
You're welcome.
Well, without further ado, don't want to hold folks up in their wonderful mornings. Please have a happy Thursday and continue attending August faculty workshop, and good luck for the remaining, the beginning of your school year.